Hi students, in this class of mineral metabolism, we will cover copper metabolism. Copper or cuprum, you know, is a very important mineral and it's included in competency number 6.9 and 6.10, which covers all the minerals. Now, to start with, you should know total body copper is about 100 mg. Alright, and it's present in muscles, liver, bone marrow, heart, kidney and hair. Alright. Now, there are multiple enzymes that contain copper. Okay, if you remember these, you can actually remember the functions of copper, actions of copper as well as deficiency disorders. Alright, so yes, remembering so many enzymes might be cumbersome, but if you recall, and if you note the names, you will see most of these already have been covered. Okay, ceruloplasmin, you already know in iron metabolism, ferroxidase, cytochrome oxidase in biological oxidation, cytochrome C, tyrosinase in melanin synthesis, lysyl oxidase in collagen synthesis, ALA synthase, heme synthesis, monoamine oxidase, MAO, that is degradation of catecholamines, superoxide dismutase in free radicals, and only thing that you, I think you don't know yet, is phenol oxidase. So you can ignore that name. Okay, just remember any three of these names, so that when examiner asks you name any copper containing enzymes, note that he or she is trying to get into one of these chapters or one of these pathway. So if you are smart enough and you have in mind, okay, fine, I have studied porphyria quite well, then you will answer ALA synthase. If you have got collagen structure in mind, if you are confident about collagen, you will answer lysyl oxidase. If you are confident about heme synthesis and tyrosine metabolism, you will answer tyrosinase. So, this is a very good area to lure the examiner into your own area of confidence. So, mind it and remember them and answer them accordingly. So, there are few non-enzymatic proteins, okay, that contains copper. Those are actually not important for you to remember, but the names are actually easy. Depending on the site, you will simply add cuprin. Okay, see, hepatocuprin in liver, cuprothionin, both are present in liver, cerebrocuprin in brain, hemocuprin in RBC, and erythrocuprin in bone marrow. The requirement of copper is around 1.5 to 3 mg per day, not at all important for you to remember, and most of the minerals are available in diet from leafy vegetables, and this case copper, since copper is important in our body and it is present in muscle and liver. Okay, see, it's present in liver, bone marrow and muscles. It means animal sources, the meat, chicken, etc., whatever you are taking, those non-vegans, you will get copper from that source. However, you should know milk, just like iron, milk is a very poor content, very poor in copper content, okay? And the excretion of copper is mainly through the biliary system. Now, similarly, now in case of iron, we saw that urine was not containing iron at all. Kidney does not take part even in excreting 1% of iron. But in case of copper, there are presence in very trace quantities in case of normal situation. Okay, so iron, kidneys are not taking part in either maintaining the level of copper or iron. Okay, however, urine content of copper is still very, very low compared to that of iron. Now, what's the use or function of copper? There are many. You should remember a few. The number one thing that you can tell me by now is that of ceruloplasmin. Okay, how ceruloplasmin, it was helping in ferroxidase activity. Right. Anyway, so it's actually necessary for mobilization of iron from mucosal and RE cells and hepatic parenchymal cells through the action of ceruloplasmin. Thus, incorporation of iron into hemoglobin needs copper. So it is helping in iron metabolism. Even if you don't write all this thing in detail, just you can comment that aids in absorption of, not only absorption, aids in mobilization and internalization of iron by its peroxidase activity. Next, recall the enzymes and will be able to recall the function necessary for tyrosinase activity and hence melanin synthesis. As I told you, lysyl oxidase, so it's a cofactor of vitamin C requiring hydroxylation reaction. Next, it increases HDL, so it protects the heart. Actually, in case of copper deficiency, heart disorder happens. How it does it, this mechanism is not for you to know. Even if you can choose to forget the whole HDL thing, the only important thing at your level to remember, you should must know, is the action of ceruloplasmin. It acts as a peroxidase, and in the mean and doing this, it gets reduced. So bivalent or divalent copper gets reduced to monovalent Cu plus iron. Okay, so Cu2 plus gets converted to Cu plus, and in the process it accepts an electron and converts Fe2 plus to Fe3 plus. Now, two diseases. Trust me, this is the second last slide, okay, because copper is not a very lengthy topic to study. Neither you can invest more than 10 minutes in revising copper before the day of exam. Okay, if you at all choose to revise copper, if you can, if you choose to forget copper, if you choose to ignore copper, I will be sad. And if examiner asks you a question and you cannot tell it, then you will be sad after the exam. So better not ignore copper. That's why I am teaching this. So the first is Wilson's disease. You will get a short note on Wilson's disease. And trust me, when you go to medicine ward, Wilson's disease, you may spot a case of Wilson's disease which may not be diagnosed in the first go. But later it will be diagnosed after ruling out all the important differential diagnosis. So what happens in Wilson disease? Ceruloplasmin level is low. Okay, actually it is known as hepatolenticular degeneration because the lens in the eye and the liver both undergoes degeneration. So cirrhosis of liver along with lenticular degeneration. Now see, not only lens in the eye, I am giving you a homework. What do you mean by hepatolenticular degeneration? Please, you should do a research on your own. I am not telling you in detail because brain has not been covered yet in anatomy. Okay, once you, if the brain would have been covered, I would have told you, but now it will be difficult to understand and visualize what part of brain gets degenerated. Because of this, patient may have seizures and abnormal movements. They are very common in Wilson's disease. Now, what's the basic defect? Basic defect is the problem in this gene, ATP7B gene. Okay, what does it do? It actually codes for enzyme copper binding ATPase. Alright, so in normal condition, the level of copper binding ATPase and the level of ATP7B gene is normal, but when it's defective, this copper binding ATPase cannot be coded. Okay, so it's deficient and it is actually needed for normal excretion of copper from liver cells. Alright, so this case, Wilson's disease, is a disorder in which excretion of copper is hampered, leading to excess accumulation of copper in the liver cells. Okay, and the two areas where copper will be deposited are liver and brain, and liver undergoes cirrhosis, and this lenticular degeneration is actually part of brain. Okay, hepato means liver, and I will not tell you what brain, but remember, brain and liver are the areas that are majorly affected in case of Wilson's disease. This much you need to know about Wilson's disease, not much. Okay, just remember ATP7B gene, ceruloplasmin level is reduced but copper level is increased, leading to problem in liver and brain. The next part, which is actually interesting, is copper deficiency anemia. You already know iron deficiency anemia, but copper deficiency also produces anemia. Why? At this level, you should be able to tell me, because the main function of copper is to help or aid iron metabolism. So if this is absent, there will be problem in iron metabolism. So how it actually affects iron metabolism? You know already it's essential for the formation of hemoglobin, right? Because ceruloplasmin helps in iron transport, and also it's a part of ALA synthase. So ALA synthase actually helps in synthesis of heme, okay? Now what happens? The copper uptake by the normoblast, I mean the iron uptake by the normoblast, okay? You know the stages of erythropoiesis? Have you been taught in physiology? If you have been taught, fine. There are stages like intermediate, normoblast, etc., etc. If not, it will be taught in pathology, okay? So, why copper deficiency is manifested as anemia? It's because it hampers heme synthesis, hemoglobin synthesis, as well as iron metabolism during hemoglobin synthesis. But a peculiar thing what happens is the number of RBCs that are produced, that is cell division of the erythroblasts, they are reduced, and the erythroblasts cannot fully mature. Somehow small sized RBCs are produced. Okay, note this thing, the amount of hemoglobin present is more or less normal. Okay, why? Because the amount of hemoglobin depends on the demand of the RBCs, okay, the synthesis. If 100 RBCs are synthesized, suppose body is producing 10 gram of hemoglobin. If 500 RBCs are synthesized, it will produce 50 gram of hemoglobin just to maintain the balance. But in this case, what happens? Synthesis of hemoglobin is the first priority. So hemoglobin amount is already reduced due to problem in heme synthesis, that is ALA synthase and iron absorption. So heme synthesis is reduced and hemoglobin synthesis is already reduced. Based on that, the erythroblasts and normoblasts synthesize less number of RBC. The number of RBCs are less and they are also small size, so that they can cope up with the small amount of hemoglobin that has been given to them. This leads to a scenario where the RBC count is reduced, the cell size is small, but the hemoglobin concentration is more or less normal. Okay, remember, this is occurring when iron level is normal but copper level is low. If iron level is also low, then heme synthesis will be totally hampered. Okay, so in case of iron deficiency, both cell sizes are small and level of hemoglobin are also less. Therefore, the anemia is microcytic hypochromic. So, they also have less color. But in this case, in case of only copper deficiency, when iron level is normal, the concentration of hemoglobin is more or less normal. So, it is normochromic anemia. Of course, it is microcytic because I told you the cell size is small. The cell sizes are also small in case of iron deficiency, but in iron deficiency, the total hemoglobin synthesis is also reduced. Okay, here hemoglobin synthesis happens, but it happens slowly because the copper, which acts as a catalyst, is now performing a reduced function. Okay, so copper deficiency, what happens? Microcytic normochromic anemia, very, very, very important. In few textbooks, you may find microcytic hypochromic, yes. In few cases, in case of severe deficiency, it is also accompanied by iron deficiency, so it may produce microcytic hypochromic. But when iron is adequate and only copper is deficient, mind it, the type of anemia is microcytic normochromic anemia. Fine, so this will be a MCQ question in which microcytic hypochromic will be a distractor. So be very careful. If you see microcytic normochromic anemia, please hit that. Now we come to the last slide. Okay, yeah, you cannot believe me. You think I'm joking? I'm not. This is the last slide and classes will be over soon and you can get back to whatever you are doing. So cardiovascular diseases, as I told you, it was actually producing HDL, right? So an HDL helps in, this is a good cholesterol, okay? That if you even forget that, you should know that it helps in collagen synthesis, okay? And collagen, not only collagen, also other connective tissues, because it acts as a cofactor of vitamin C, and vitamin C plays a sheet anchor role in manufacturing of the connective tissues, including collagen and elastin. So in case of copper deficiency, what happens? Elastin becomes abnormal, leading to weakening of the walls of major blood vessels. This favor aneurysm and fatal rupture of wall of aorta. What is aneurysm? You will read that in medicine. Aneurysm means a balloon like swelling in arterial wall due to pressure. Some, you see, if when you are inflating a balloon, if an area is very thin, due to manufacturing defect, that area will bulge. Okay, similar thing happens in case of arterial walls. There is a lateral pressure of blood, and if an area is thinned out, it actually balloons out, and that becomes a very risky area to get ruptured and leads to internal hemorrhage and death, especially aneurysm in brain. You will read in brain something called circle of Willis. Okay, so aneurysm in circle of Willis leads to fatal intracerebral hemorrhage and death. That is not at all desired. And of course, if aorta is ruptured, then also the bleeding cannot be controlled and patient will die of hemorrhagic and hypovolemic shock, right? So number one is cardiovascular diseases. Number two, very interesting and very funny disorder. The name itself is funny: Minky's Kinky Hair Syndrome. Actually, when I am teaching you, I actually wanted to show you the picture of Minky's Kinky Hair Syndrome. Okay, it's very funny. The hairs are all straight and curled, not curled, the hairs are all straight like Van de Graaff genitalia, as if you have, the person has been electrocuted. Okay, just Google it, you will be able to find a funny picture of Minky's Kinky Hair Syndrome. Of course, we won't be seeing it in ward anytime soon, but I missed it. I actually thought of incorporating a picture and then I forgot. Anyway, so it's an X-linked defect. Strangely, it's because it's X-linked recessive, it only affects male children. Okay, remember, it's X-linked recessive. There is another type of disorder, that is Y-linked disorders. Those are also only affecting male children. Okay, but this is the X-linked recessive disorder. Remember, the problem in ATP7B gene was giving rise to Wilson's disease. Okay, see, ATP7B gene, Wilson's disease, and ATP7A gene leads to Minky's Kinky Hair Syndrome. Okay, this is a problem, that was a problem in excretion of copper, right? So copper was getting accumulated over there. This one is due to the problem in absorption of dietary copper. Okay, what happens? Copper first gets absorbed, okay, but then it cannot be transported due to deficiency of this one, intracellular copper binding ATPase, right? You can contrast every time with Wilson's disease, more or less same, okay? This copper binding ATPase was helping in excretion in bile, and this helps in intracellular transport, okay? Now, the copper that has entered into the cell, okay, is not able to get out. See, the problem is in transport, not absorption, I'm sorry. When it is absorbed, the whole thing is actually absorption. It will get absorbed in the mucosal cells, and then it gets transported into the bloodstream, into the liver. Okay, the whole thing is absorption. So if you strictly say, the problem is in transport because it lacks the copper binding ATPase gene. Fine. So now it gets accumulated in the mucosal cells. But even if it's accumulated, it is actually deficient. Why? Because copper is not available for metabolism. After accumulation in the mucosal cells, the copper needs to travel to the bloodstream in order to exert its biological functions. But in this case, it is deficient. Major deficiency symptoms are in collagen and connective tissue disorders, leading to this type, that is Binky's Kinky Hair Syndrome. Okay. Now, often both of the deficiency symptoms happen simultaneously. So, ATP7A and ATP7B, both are problematic. So, there are cases in which Wilson's disease doesn't happen. See, Minky's Kinky Hair Syndrome is not a life-threatening disorder, but Wilson's disease is a life-threatening disorder. So, mutation of ATP7A is a bit milder compared to the disease in which ATP7B is mutated. So, if you are asked just name two diseases, you should mention Wilson's disease and Minky's Kinky Hair Syndrome, because you will get another question, that is mention the genetic defect. So, if you are able to mention ATP7A and ATP7B, it will carry a very good impression on part of examiners and you will get good marks. Anyways, last but not the least, melanin deficiency due to problem in tyrosinase activity. Tyrosinase is a copper containing enzyme, and if copper is deficient, tyrosinase will not be able to function properly, and thus copper deficiency will produce hypopigmentation. Fine. So let us revise what we studied. And we studied copper containing enzymes. Okay. Very important. These are most important, and you need to know the function of, at least name of all of them and answer them cleverly in Viva to invite further question. Next, you should know the function of ceruloplasmin, that is peroxidase activity. Okay. Next, Wilson's disease, ATP7B, and hepatolenticular degeneration, that is a problem in excretion of copper, and copper deficiency anemia, and specifically the type, that is microcytic normochromic anemia. Okay. Last but not the least, cardiovascular diseases, Minky's Kinky Hair Syndrome, ATP7A, and hypopigmentation due to defect in melanin synthesis. So, thank you so much for attending all the classes of mineral metabolism. If you have not attended my previous classes, there are classes of calcium metabolism, which is divided into two parts, as well as iron metabolism, which has been divided into two parts. These are the three most important minerals from which question comes in theory and practical for your undergraduate MBBS paper. So, feel free to get back to me in the comment section, and I will see you in the next one with another exciting series in the biochemistry channel. Till then, bye and take care.